September 20th, 2019. The Smart Araneta Coliseum played host to the first WWE event in the Philippines since 2016. Longtime Filipino wrestling fans like myself have been accustomed to being a low-priority market for the WWE. House shows come along once every 3 to 4 years or so here, typically with a pretty standard card that gets toured in various markets in Asia and Europe. But this time, this wasn't just any other WWE house show. It was special for a couple of reasons. First, it was my girlfriend Ika's first ever live wrestling show. She's a wrestling fan to the extent that many significant others to longtime fans are. She approaches wrestling with loving tolerance that occasionally spikes into genuine enjoyment. She brought her cousin with her, someone who grew up on wrestling the way many Filipino kids did in the 2000s. We all had a good time. Secondly, it was special because for the first time in my life, I got to watch Daniel Bryan live. He wrestled Kofi Kingston that night in a rematch of their WrestleMania Match of the Year affair. I'd been a fan of Daniel Bryan for a decade at this point, and seeing him on that night working an inconsequential house show match in front of an audience that would have gladly paid the price of admission just to see him walk down to the ring, I experienced firsthand something that any wrestling fan wants to experience at least once in their life. I watched the greatest wrestler of all time perform live. Will things ever be the same again? It's a wild, wild, wild.
The wild, wild, wild.
It's been a little over a year since I uploaded the first version of this video, the essay that really sparked my drive to grow this channel to the point that it's at now. In that time, I've made allusions to that now long gone video both on this channel and on my Twitter account, and people have asked me when it would come back or how they could see it. So here we are. The first thing worth remembering before we get into the thick of things is that I am making this video while having committed the cardinal sin of not watching every wrestling match ever committed to accessible videotape in the history of man. This is an obvious fact, but just for sheer transparency, I think it's fair for me to point out some major blind spots in my pro wrestling fandom to give you guys a better idea of where this declaration of mine comes from. So let's put it on record that most of my pro wrestling viewing is centered around the United States and Japan from around 1970 or so onwards. That means some of my biggest blind spots are a lack of in-depth knowledge of lucha libre, I've only had a dip into Joshi that has yet to be properly re-evaluated, and pretty much I have zero knowledge or experience with anything from the English pro wrestling scene from the World of Sport era. So if you want to argue for Negro Casas, Aja Kong, or Fit Finley, then please be my guest. Second point of note is that, surprise, surprise, this entire video is constructed around an opinion. Much like every other creative venture in the world, pro wrestling is built on such a wide variety of criterions for success that arguments for who is the greatest of all time are innately biased from the get-go. Oftentimes, the arguments that people put forth in an attempt to validate their claims also end up being highly subjective appraisals of quality based on one's personal experiences and priorities when approaching wrestling. This is fine. Different people interpret wrestling in different ways, and everyone has their own barometer for what defines good and bad wrestling. All we can truly do is be honest with ourselves when we communicate how and why these opinions form. This video, in essence, not only acts as a case builder for Daniel Bryan, but almost as an aesthetic declaration. More than any other video I've done, this one I hope makes clear the particular aspects of an individual performer that I look for when making evaluations of their body of work as a pro wrestler. And when it comes to evaluating a wrestler's whole career, the two things I look for on top of a high marker of quality are versatility and volume. Quite simply, you have to be good at everything and do everything a lot. So let's get started. One of the easiest markers of success to pinpoint for a wrestler is longevity. Not only how long does a wrestler remain active as a competitor, but for how long have they been putting in the high quality work that you expect of someone who could be called the greatest of all time. Daniel Bryan made his professional debut in 1999, 21 years ago. I would argue that of those 21 years, he's been putting on great to transcendent performances for roughly 19 of them.
I will say I think he's the best wrestler of the last 20 years. So if we go back to the year 2000, probably when he was finishing his training at TWA, I think that there's been no more consistent performer.
Definitely the first time I ever heard of him or saw him was the ECWA Super 8 in 2001, which was kind of the big independent tournament at the time. He had an amazing run to the finals, including a great match against Loki in the finals. That was the first time I saw him.
Based on the footage that I've been able to access, we see that he has some really strong performances starting around 2001 against both Loki and his mentor, William Regal. Although in these 2001 matches, it's fair to say that Loki was the better rounded performer, Bryan is able to bridge the gap between them by the time we get to their third match of the year in the finals of the APW King of the Indies tournament.
Stuff so ahead of its time in terms of hybrid styling, and the idea of how he was able to incorporate, you know, all of his grappling into that is something that always stood out to me.
As early as 2001, we already see flashes of some of the traits that would make Bryan such a timeless talent. His realistic grappling, his attention to detail, his creative offense, and his believable selling. Combine that with a strong match layout that builds to a natural climax, and you have a powerful statement from a young wrestler looking to make their reputation in the industry.
You knew you were watching something special. You knew you were watching a technical master, and there was just something about him, the intensity, the execution of the things he did. It set him apart, and you knew he was going to be really good. I don't think anybody could guess at that point what he would become, but you knew he was a cut above.
I always thought he had good technique. I enjoyed watching him because he always did interesting maneuvers on the mat and interesting ways to get into things. I think I liked his matches with Spanky the most at that time. They would just really tear into each other.
As you probably know, Daniel Bryan continues to wrestle for the WWE to this day at an extremely high level of quality. In fact, it's almost impossible to say that he's lost anything from his former days on the independent scene, simply adjusted his style to better suit the needs of WWE television as a medium. That's an insane amount of time to be wrestling at such a high caliber, and the fact that we have yet to even see a sign of actual decay from Bryan's ring work means that we don't even know the ceiling on how much longer Bryan could go on at the rate that he's currently working at. But Bryan isn't just some workhorse toiling year after year on the mid-card wherever he's at. In every single promotion that Bryan has worked in, he has been treated as a top-level draw, whether the company wanted to or not.
He would always stand out. He wouldn't ever have a bad match, to me anyway, in my eyes. And I think you could tell that he really perfected his craft. Every stage of his career, he would really go out there to be the best performer out of everyone else that he would share the locker room with.
From 2006 to 2009, Bryan was easily the king of the independent scene, the undisputed best independent pro wrestler in the world. Not only as the top star in Ring of Honor, Bryan's work spreads out across the indie world in PWG, WXW in Germany, and even some dates in 2009 as a top-level special attraction in Chikara. Once Samoa Joe, CM Punk, and Loki left the independent scene, Bryan was the attraction on the independents that could be counted on to improve both the drawing power and overall quality of any show that he was on.
That came not because Gabe Sapolsky, the booker at the time, was like, hey, you're going to be the guy.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he decided I needed to be the guy because everybody else had left. You know, like CM Punk had gotten signed by WWE, Samoa Joe had gotten signed by TNA.
Yeah.
Jamie Noble, who was wrestling under his real name, James Gibson at the time, he made him the champion, but then he got picked up back again by WWE. And
yeah.
So it's like, who do we have? Well, Bryan's still here.
Yeah.
Like,
in the WWE, Daniel Bryan has been the most beloved babyface of the past decade. He's a key player of two of the best WrestleMania moments in recent memory, one as a babyface winning the title, and one as a heel dropping the belt. Despite the company's long history of mismanaging talent and ignoring the fans, Daniel Bryan remained undeniable. But Joseph, I hear you typing away furiously. Daniel Bryan was never a top-level draw on the scale of a Rock or an Austin or a Hogan. If you ask me personally, drawing power might be the least important criterion that people turn to when discussing the greatest of all time. It has the least to do with the actual performer and more to do with the circumstances around them. Who's booking, what promotion are they in, and what kind of business is that promotion doing? And past that, there's the state of the national and global economy and how that affects the wrestling industry as a whole. And on a personal note, drawing power as a discussion in evaluating a wrestler is just the most boring possible angle to take for me as a critic. If we're solely going to limit ourselves to the people who drew the biggest houses, we'll be talking about the same 5 or 6 people forever. I would much rather spend my time picking apart the aspects of wrestling that mean the most to me as a viewer. The performance, both in the ring and out, rather than just us talk about who brought in how many people when. All that aside, the fact of the matter is that by the time Bryan was in the WWE, the company had either forgotten how to or entirely refused to book anyone as a top babyface draw. The focus of the company drifted away from positioning a single person as the centerpiece of the show and instead moved towards forwarding the promotion itself as the attraction to bring people in. And yet, in spite of that, Daniel Bryan was able to connect with the fans through sheer force of his charisma and talent in the ring. By the power of his skill, Daniel Bryan elevated himself to the top of the card in spite of the WWE and remains one of the most valuable members of its roster to this day.
Bryan Danielson is the greatest wrestler of all time. A bold, uncompromising, and definitive statement, you might say. It is something, however, that I have said with no little confidence since the very first time I saw him wrestle live and in person all the way back in 2006. My first live experience of the American Dragon was his historic ROH title unification match against Nigel McGuinness in Liverpool in 2006. The match, of course, has become legendary and notorious for the extraordinary and brutal lengths to which both men went. The spot where Danielson repeatedly rammed Nigel's head into the ring post is as violent and uncomfortable as pro wrestling has ever been. But memorable and harrowing as that spot was, it was Danielson's performance first and foremost that will always be etched in my memory. He was masterful that night. I remember being struck by the sheer force of his personality. From the moment that his music hit, it felt like he owned the room. He was always going to be the hated heel on this particular night, as he took on the British hero on his home turf. But no one could have imagined the howls of derision that greeted him as he gleefully instructed ring announcer Bobby Cruz to announce him as even better than the Beatles. For all the big and memorable spots in this match, it was, as always, in the fine detail of the match that Danielson excelled. Wrestled under ROH pure title rules, the rope breaks were a crucial part of the story. In the early going, Danielson worked over Nigel's arm with all the ferocity of a rabid pit bull. Each rope break that Nigel did give up was in some way a callback to this early limb work. The first an armbar, the second his signature cattle mutilation, and the third a cross-faced chicken wing with the injured arm trapped. This was a master storyteller at the peak of his powers. Everything that Danielson did was efficient and had meaning within the context of the match. There was little or no wasted action. The greatness of this match, of course, was its escalation from keenly contested mat work into an all-out bloody war. It was Danielson who administered that brutal ring post shot, an amazing depiction of a champion who will do anything to keep his belt. The match showcased the full range of his abilities, from enthralling mat worker to violent brawler. It is an often forgotten fact that prior to this match, Nigel was not yet seen by the fickle ROH fanbase as a true top guy in the company. It is no coincidence that it is only through going toe-to-toe with Danielson that he was finally accepted as such. Could anyone else have elevated him, even in defeat, as well as Danielson did here? Could anyone have drawn the previously unseen babyface fire from Nigel that Danielson did, as he hulked up covered in blood with the crowd rising as one to meet him? If Nigel was Austin at WrestleMania 13 here, turning babyface while passed out in a pool of his own blood, then Danielson was very much Bret Hart, a remorseless, all-time great technician who dug deep into the darkest part of his soul to pull off a career-defining win. As a defiant, imperious Danielson stood gloating in the ring with both belts held aloft and with missiles raining down on him from a furious crowd, I struggled to comprehend everything that I had just witnessed. I had just seen the greatest match I would ever see in person, and I had been in the presence of the greatest wrestler to ever grace a wrestling ring.
This point is easily the one with the most material we can discuss while simultaneously being the most patently obvious argument that I could have. Of course Daniel Bryan is a great wrestler, that's his whole thing. It's been his whole thing for pretty much the entirety of his career, and it's the general crux of his value as a performer. But as with many things that are obvious on the surface, I think it's something that a lot of people tend to take for granted. It's so understood that Bryan is great that we end up actually diminishing how good he really is in the ring.
Everyone will try to make things as real as possible because, like I said, every fan thinks that they know everything, so he was one of the main ones that made it seem like this was a real thing that was happening. And not in the shitty way where it's like, oh fuck, this is a shoot, or like, he's really trying to hurt him, but it was just like, this is a real struggle between two individuals and one of them, and both of them are trying to win in this fight.
So first, let's talk about the volume of great matches that Bryan has provided us over the years. Since 2001, Bryan has put out a handful of 4-plus star matches every single year that he's been active. And again, I emphasize that he's been doing this essentially non-stop since 2001, a streak broken up only by the significant times he spent away due to injury. He has wrestled in multiple 5-star matches, under my own metrics of course, in which he played varying roles in different styles of matchup.
So let's look at Bryan's career, right? Great matches with Loki, great matches with Christopher Daniels, great matches with Nigel, with Morishima, with Kenta, with Marufuji, with Nakajima, those guys, right? Then you throw him into the WWE world, and he goes out there and works with The Big Show. He goes out there and he works with Mark Henry. And he has, you know, interesting matches with these guys.
Now, if we're looking at Dave Meltzer star ratings, Daniel Bryan has never clocked in a 5-star match, which, if you ask me, is far more proof that Dave Meltzer's star ratings are ridiculous than they are proof that Daniel Bryan is a lesser wrestler than, say, Kazuchika Okada or Mitsuharu Misawa. If you look at Bryan's match-to-match performances, I think you might find that Bryan has a far more consistent and substantial body of work than either of those two performers, and I do stand by that. even just looking at the peaks of their work, you'll find that Okada and Misawa have very clear-cut stylistic choices across all their most celebrated work. Luckily for Brian, he's been able to flex his abilities across a multitude of styles over the years, and that does a lot to boost his value in my eyes.
Whether he's facing a luchador, a high flyer, another technician, or a guy 200 pounds heavier than him, he's always able to make it work and look effortless.
Perhaps the genre that most hardcore Brian fans associate him with is the lengthy work rate epic, popularized by ROH in the early to mid-2000s. In this style, we see a lot of Brian's most celebrated early work. There's the 2 out of 3 falls matches against Paul London and Austin Aries, the latter of which famously going 76 minutes without being a complete mess and actually being pretty great. There's the ROH World title match with Samoa Joe in 2004, and then there's Brian's own lengthy ROH World title reign. These matches display Brian's intelligence in earning and retaining a crowd's attention with smart layouting and perfect pacing.
My favorite Brian Danielson performances would probably be the series of Nigel McGuinness matches mixed with the series of Morishima matches. Then, therein mixed with, on top of all of that, the Roderick Strong matches.
Brian's 2005 ROH World Championship defense against Roderick Strong is one of the better examples of this, as it goes close to 50 minutes. Brian masterfully controls the pace as the champion trying to ground a much harder hitting and explosive challenger. The sense of struggle that Brian brings to the mat work while also expressing the fear and anger inspired in him by Roddy's brutal chops is fantastic. But if you think that Brian needs 50 minutes to put on a classic, you're sorely mistaken. In just the past month alone, Brian has shown himself to be great in much shorter formats as well. He's been having incredibly strong television matches that don't ever go much longer than 15 minutes against the likes of Cesaro and Sami Zayn.
He can have like a 2-minute match, but he doesn't have to like do 50,000 things in that 2-minute match, like trying to fit 10 pounds of shit in a 5-pound bag. Like, he's just very good at maximizing his time and what he knows what he needs to do to get the job done and to make it seem like it's the best match he ever fought.
This ability to thrive in more condensed matches extends all the way back to his time on the indies. One of his best matches of 2007 was an 11-minute all-out brawl against the Necro Butcher in PWG. In that small time frame, Brian is able to include some great intensity as he tries to out-wrestle the brutish madman in Necro Butcher. This match also serves to highlight one of Brian's most underrated abilities, being a great brawler.
And it's actually something I feel very comfortable doing. And one of the things that I really dislike is the hardcore matches or street fight matches that involve a lot of setup. We just fought around the chairs. It's not set up a table here as a prop and, you know, make it all nice and pretty and then give him a move through it.
For someone with the reputation of being a scientific work rate wrestler, Brian has shown some pretty consistent excellence in gimmick matches throughout his entire career. Notable examples include his street fight versus Randy Orton on Raw in 2013, pretty much every Elimination Chamber that Brian's ever been in, and the peak of this probably comes in his Fight Without Honor against Takeshi Morishima from 2008, the climax to their violent feud stemming from Morishima detaching Brian's retina in 2007.
And I saw him against Morishima when he dislocated his retina. I was like, holy shit, that's the fucking craziest thing I've seen in my entire life.
Yuji Danielson was the kind of dickhead heel bully, where now he's got to go against the bigger bully. And how is he going to overcome that bigger bully? What's his game plan going to be? the detached retina, so many storylines there with Morishima.
He had his matches with Morishima, where Morishima was a big guy and a, you know, kind of a bruiser. But you could just see in his body language sometime that Morishima did not have that violence in him. You know, he just didn't have that urgency in him. But Danielson found a way to get it out of him and just had some epic encounters.
The match exemplifies Brian's philosophies of brawling. Instead of having overly complicated setups, it focuses instead on a single weapon, the chain. It plays a key part in the main transitioning between control segments and is also the main prop that plays into the finishing sequence. Despite only using one weapon and one that isn't quite as visually spectacular as a chair or a table, Brian and Morishima put on what I believe to be a 5-star classic here, as everything feels like an organic fight between these two men trying to wrap up their year and a half long feud. At the same time, Brian's shown skill at operating on the complete opposite side of the tonal spectrum. His time on the Independents has shown that he's incredibly adept at working comedy matches without violating the realistic nature of his kayfabe. The comedy spots that Brian works always exist within the same space as his more serious work. Just look at his opening round match in the 2009 King of Trios. Much of the early match sees Brian toying with his opponents in a comedic manner, but when the match takes a more serious turn, when the Rudos isolate Brian in the ring, his instincts for limb selling and good psychology come back into a play. It's such a perfect handling of the lighter environment in Chikara combined with the nuanced ring psychology that Brian brings to his ROH epics.
And from a wrestler's perspective, this guy had a wrestling IQ that was far beyond almost anybody that you'd come across. I mean, genius levels, and he was just so good at being flexible. You know, he was able to excel in every style. I mean, it didn't matter if it was hard-hitting Japanese style, American style with the entertainment aspect of it, the lucha libre stuff, shoot style, catch as catch can, the European grappling style. You know, he just was so good at doing all these different things.
This level of versatility between genres is a key element of Brian's success, as it allows him to thrive in basically any pro wrestling environment that he's ever been thrown into. Whether it's the meta comedic tone of PWG, the family-friendly entertainment of Chikara, the ultra-serious work rate of ROH, or the flashy, over-the-top nature of the WWE, Daniel Bryan has excelled and risen to the top every single time.
The fancy stuff isn't... For me, that's not how I've made a living in professional wrestling. How I've made a living is being really good at the basic stuff. Cool moves don't matter, guys. As much as in indie wrestling, it'll get you this, but it doesn't get people behind you. Just realize that the basics, getting good at all this stuff, the footwork, you know, anything that you can improve, the footwork, headlock stuff. Now, a lot of independent wrestlers, and it's always been like this, you know, people forego the small stuff in order to get to the big stuff. They don't do headlocks properly in order to get the brainbusters and things like that. But if you do the headlocks properly and you use that stuff to get crowd reactions, by the time you get to a brainbuster, Austin Aries is a perfect example, I think, of a guy who does a lot less than most people in, say, a company like Ring of Honor that's built around like big stuff, big crazy stuff. Right now, Austin Aries doesn't do a whole lot of crazy stuff, but everything he does is really good. By the time he hits that brainbuster, people are booing him or cheering him or whatnot, you know. And so, just try to work on all the basic stuff.
It's that foundation of excellent basics and fundamentals that allows Brian to shift and change his style to be so well-rounded across multiple genres and multiple promotions.
I think that a lot of, I guess, normal, everyday fans don't really understand the little things that he does in the ring that a wrestler would understand. One big thing was when he first came back after his neck, after his neck injury in WWE, he would put his comeback in his shine. And I had never really seen anyone do that. And like the Tiger Fang backflip, duck clothesline thing. He started putting that in the beginning of his match. I was like, oh, that's a really cool way to start to get the crowd up right at the beginning, and then it's just go time from there.
I think what separates Bryan Danielson from other performers is, like I said, his realness. He can be rugged, he can be really technical, he can be fully knowledgeable about all different aspects of wrestling. His best assets, probably, I guess, just his ability to soak up knowledge based on his environment, because that's what I could see from seeing him perform in the ring. You could tell that if he had spent time watching or studying something in particular of wrestling, that he would really bring that to the forefront and ensure to apply that in his wrestling to the utmost degree. He wouldn't do it half-assed. He would study it till he knew it through and through, and then he would do it really well.
The old adage goes that a great wrestler can have a fantastic match with a broomstick. Daniel Bryan can do you one better. He had a great match with The Fiend.
Bryan Danielson is the most selfless wrestler in the world. If you look at it from a perspective of getting everybody else over at his own expense. Whereas Bryan Danielson, win or lose, has always looked amazing. Whether in his goal, you know, you can almost tell in matches, is that of like a Terry Funk when he came into ECW of, how can I make this guy and how can he be more viable from wrestling me? And that's something that I think if you look at Danielson throughout his career, it's always been. Anybody who's wrestled Danielson usually gets the rub into something bigger.
The magic of any truly elite level worker is how well they're able to work around the limitations of those around them. Daniel Bryan has consistently made the best of every opponent thrown his way for the past two decades, even when those opponents have been far, far, far below his own level of talent. This is something that's most apparent in the WWE, of course. Miz's feud with Daniel Bryan in late 2010, for example, culminated with Bryan winning the US Championship in exactly the kind of credibility-building boost that The Miz needed to confuse WWE management and the audience into believing that he was actually a good idea for main eventing the following year's WrestleMania. When I ask you, what's Bray Wyatt's best singles match, what's the first thing to come to mind? A few of you might point to the Roman Reigns Hell in a Cell, but I'm willing to bet that most of you are thinking of the singles match he had with Daniel Bryan at the 2014 Royal Rumble. If you're not, then you might be thinking of the strap match against Daniel Bryan at this year's Royal Rumble. For me personally, the latter of those matches is even more impressive than the 2014 edition. Why? Because The Fiend is far and away a worse gimmick and a worse wrestler than Bray Wyatt was. It's just an act designed to make all the wrong decisions until Bryan came along and proved that you could somehow get something excellent out of the guy.
And that's something that Bryan Danielson was amazing at, you know, making his opponents look just great, like $1 million. And doing so in a really, he just makes everything look so easy. Everything looks so easy to him, and I'm sure he's one of those guys who I just think is such a natural talent that we're all so jealous of, because a lot of us have to just work really hard for this sort of thing.
In 2018, with Bryan freshly back from his imposed retirement, the WWE made the decision to saddle Bryan with Big Cass, an act that had zero upside and zero potential at the time. Bryan put the big man on his back and dragged him to his best singles match to date on pay-per-view. Bryan had zero reason to make Cass look as good as he did, but he gave him a hand anyway, because that's just how Bryan's always approached wrestling. In 2019, a poorly timed injury for Mustafa Ali meant that longtime WWE mid-carder Kofi Kingston received a push that, out of nowhere, gained a surge of groundswell support from the audience. Kofi Kingston is not a bad wrestler. He's a fantastic TV worker, an amazing tag worker, but he just didn't have the singles experience as a main event draw chasing the WWE Championship. Luckily for Kofi Kingston, the WWE Champion at the time was the greatest wrestler of all time. Across three matches, the 2019 Elimination Chamber, the WrestleMania title match, and the rematch on Raw, Bryan went out of his way to make Kofi Kingston look every bit the heroic world beater that fans wanted him to be. Even if the reign that followed could never match the lofty standard that Bryan helped set, there's no denying that Bryan did pretty much everything in his power to make Kofi Kingston look like the WWE champion we always wanted.
That is what the fans don't see, is that even you don't really see Danielson's losses per se, because he makes everybody else look so good when he loses. Okay, and that's one of the things. Bryan Danielson is the most selfless wrestler of the last 25 years. I don't see Bryan Danielson being the backstage politic guy to say, well, I need to win to look strong, because Danielson is so confident in his own abilities as a pro wrestler that he doesn't need that stuff. It says something about him in a world where everybody's worried about wins and losses and looking strong.
This is the kind of value-adding work that Bryan's been putting in throughout his entire career. Stepping into the ring with Bryan more often than not brings out the absolute best of any of his opponents. So much so that when you look back on his long career, it's hard to say just who Bryan's signature opponent is. No, really, think about it. If I ask who Bryan's best opponent is, odds are that 4 or 5 different people come to mind. Is it Loki for the series of matches that helped put the American independent scene on the map? Nigel McGuinness for the emotional years-long feud they had in Ring of Honor? The Miz for how inextricably linked their careers in the WWE have been despite being diametrically opposed performers? Randy Orton for their numerous battles over the top prizes in the WWE? All of them are correct answers because Bryan made his opponents shine to the absolute best of their abilities.
Being in a match with a guy like that is a breeze because they have such a great mind for professional wrestling. They have such a handle on how to put matches together, how to make things flow. And that part is always the hardest part. The physicality, for me anyways, was always easy. And luckily, Bryan, in spite of his technical prowess, knew how to bring it.
Bryan is the kind of guy where he's okay not calling anything in the ring. And the problem with that, or the difficulty with that, is you have to have a feel for the crowd when you don't call it in the ring, or when you don't call it in the back. Because I've just seen so many matches where guys just go out there and do stuff, and then it is okay. It might even be good, but it is not as particularly satisfying as it could have been if you would have put a little more thought into it, or been a little bit more deliberate with the way you structure things. But Bryan is a guy that I could always go out there with very minimal structure, just have some bullet points that we would want to do, and we would go out there and we would spend, you know, the first 20 minutes just on the mat seeing what happens and developing little stories off of that, which is always fun.
That's the kind of next level magic that Bryan's capable of with his ring work. It's a generous approach to wrestling, a giving one that extends not only to the people he shares the ring with, but to the fans as well. Think, for example, of the legendary 76-minute match that Bryan and Austin Aries wrestled in 2004. Bryan's original, incredibly ambitious plan for the match was to end the first two falls with back-to-back 60-minute time limit draws before he finally lost the match 50 minutes into the third and final fall. But when in the ring, he realized that he didn't have the crowd's attention to go that long. He put ambition aside and improvise to do something much more palatable, yet still ambitious and impressive. It's that brilliance of ring work allowing him to be so in tune with both his opponents and the audience that makes him so great.
A match that really stands out personally in making the case as to why Bryan Danielson is the greatest wrestler of all time is that in any situation, no matter who it was, no matter where in the world it was, he always gave you his 100% best effort and always tried his best to send the fans home satisfied. And to me, there's no greater example of that than when he went to Triple X Wrestling in 2008 and faced a very young Zack Sabre Jr. This is a 19 to 20 year old Zack just trying to figure his way out through the business, and Bryan Danielson is already this solidified megastar. Another note here is that the English wrestling scene is a far cry from what it is now. It's a good amount of time away from the progresses and PCWs and ICWs and IPWs and RevPro merging and all that stuff that would eventually come together at this perfect time to create this big supernova of the English independent wrestling scene. That all hasn't happened yet. So what's happening is that Bryan is facing Zack in a bar, pretty much a pub, with maybe 20 people there, 30 people there max, there to watch this show. And we know plenty of stories, we've seen it ourselves, we're big wrestling fans, as these superstar guys come in and they're not always giving 100% of their effort. It's load management, it's not going in there to kill yourself when you can play the hits and send everybody home happy. But Ryan doesn't do that here. And there's a specific moment here where that becomes very clear. Now, there is a mix-up in this match as to where I don't know whether the referee, which I've been told is a very young Damian Dunn, or Zack Sabre Jr. messed us up here, but there's a very tight and snug pin that Bryan cradles Zack in. And regardless of who messed up, Zack just doesn't kick out. And you can see that wasn't the intended finish. That's not how that was meant to happen. And immediately, from the referee to Bryan to the promoter of the wrestling show, everyone's talking and trying to figure out what to do and what happened and everything. And Bryan, in his position of power, could have easily said, "Well, you guys messed up. Whatever happened, I'm done. I got paid. I'm gonna go home." But that's not what Bryan did here. Bryan, being this selfless model of what a pro wrestler should be, decided that, hey, we're wrestling, we're gonna improvise some things. And he decided that he's gonna talk to this little girl that had been so vocal throughout this entire match. And he asked the little girl up front, the only Daniel Bryan fan in the building, if she would like to see a second fall between himself and Zack Sabre Jr. And obviously she says yes. And that's the way we get into this redone version of everything that they had planned prior to the botched pin. And in this, you see Zack get a fall on Bryan and incense Bryan, demanding a third and final fall to really determine who the better guy is here. And obviously Bryan winds up putting Zack away. Bryan is way, way beyond Zack, and just getting to beat in the ring with someone like Bryan did so much for Zack. This was something that won Match of the Year in various English wrestling publications, and something that was sort of a holy grail match for myself. It's a match that I spent years looking for, and I was so excited to finally see it and see that it lived up to the hype. It just is one of those cases where I think Bryan sets himself apart from everybody else. In a moment where things went awry and he could have easily said that I don't have to do this anymore, I got paid, you guys messed up, that's not on me anymore, he decided he's here, there's no harm in still doing the right thing and doing right by the fans. 12 years later, that's still a match that we talk about as a defining moment in Zack Sabre Jr.'s career. And for Bryan, that's another day at the office. If that doesn't speak much about someone being a potential GOAT level guy, then I don't know what does.
In If you think that Brian suddenly became a good promo during his 2018 to 2019 heel turn as the Planet's champion, then you just haven't really been paying attention.
Hey, come on, Roderick! Tap out to a wrestler!
Super underrated as a promo, and just his charisma in general. You know, he gets a lot of bad rap from people who just don't pay attention or don't really understand wrestling as being bland or, you know, characterless or charismaless, and that's so incorrect. It's just crazy to think how incorrect that is.
The narrative of Brian lacking charisma or being a bad promo is one that's been exaggerated for the sake of kayfabe by Brian and the WWE. In 2009, before signing with the company, Brian would probably be the first to tell you that of his skills as a pro wrestler, promos and character work would be his greatest weakness. And while, fair enough, his work in ring far surpassed his promo work at the time, the image of the bland, independent star who couldn't entertain became magnified on purpose by Brian as well as WWE Creative for the sake of giving him an arc to overcome on the first season of NXT. It's a fabricated image based on a perceived weakness from someone who has been notoriously humble about their own work over the years.
Independent wrestling I've been able to get over mainly on my wrestling, you know, and my interviews have gotten a lot better over the years, but there's a certain style of interview that doesn't necessarily translate to WWE, so we'll see how that goes.
I just think that Brian has become so versatile, and for a guy that for years was kind of bagged on for not having a lot of personality or charisma, they even did that in the season of NXT he was on where, you know, if you had seen any of his heel Ring of Honor stuff, you'd know that he was a very engaging personality.
What the fuck do you know about wrestling? What the fuck do you know about wrestling?
Granted, Brian wasn't a transcendent promo in 2009 by any means, but to say that he was bad at them feels false. Even at that point, there are some key highlights that one can point to as displays of great mic work. Again, these come in varying styles. In 2006, we get a few awesome promos from Brian as the smarmy and overconfident heel champion of Ring of Honor.
I was hoping the ECW Arena crowd would have enough class to respect this little girl and not use all the foul language.
In 2007, he cuts a sympathetic babyface promo addressing a recent injury in the ring.
Wrestling is everything that I love. You know, the pay-per-view main events, the being in front of the live crowd, the training to be a professional athlete, you know, and all the injuries, all the detached retinas, all the separated shoulders, all the muscle tears and everything. This is the life that I wanted my entire life.
Then in 2009, he does this.
Say hello to my pod partner.
Hello.
Hello. That was good.
Oh yeah, every time that we wrestle, they go out there and they clap. It's like this. It's like... And that's great. That's great. Don't think we don't appreciate it.
It's awesome.
But with Paul Lynn and Bryan Danielson, there's a bit of a buzz going around.
Buzz.
What we'd like you people to do is join the swarm.
Join it.
So don't clap for us.
Don't clap.
We don't need to be clapped for.
No, I really
what
get
we
clapped.
Want is a buzz.
Yeah, that's not some amazing promo work or anything, but it is an amazing promo. There's a lot here to dispel the myth that he was boring or uncharismatic. Saying so would entirely ignore the fact that, as I mentioned earlier, Brian got over everywhere he went. That doesn't happen just by accident, and you can't just chalk it up to his in-ring skills either. There have been dozens of wrestlers through the years who excel in the ring that just can't quite connect with the crowd, but Brian always does.
He connects with the fans. He connected with the fans as a heel. He connected with the fans as a babyface. He's always had that kind of ideology of how to connect with a fan base.
But Danielson.
I think Brian really starts displaying a natural intensity and charisma around 2004. In this time, he's able to show off his personality in the ring a bit more, making him feel a little more well-rounded as an actual character that you can emotionally invest in, instead of just a mechanically precise wrestler.
I don't give a fuck about that!
Anyway, I think his time in Europe, his time in England was crucial to his career because he was able to work with those audiences, work with those crowds, and then, you know, try to get a reaction from people that weren't really privy to his expertise on the mat or his technique or, you know, things like that. He was able to work in front of different crowds, and he actually came back and did a lot more shtick.
I get it, and by English you mean stupid. Oh, okay. Oh, I get it. Okay. I see where you're going. Okay.
I had a distinct and great opportunity to watch Brian Danielson perform out of his element completely. Now, most people associate Brian Danielson, the American Dragon, as having these great five-star matches in front of, you know, smart, big, rowdy crowds of professional wrestling fans. But I got to see him in Florida perform at FIP in front of, you know, maybe 20, 25 people, 30 on a good day, but it was mostly kids. And he was a bad guy there. And he got these kids to hate him. I mean, they hated his guts. Like nothing I've ever seen.
He just knows how to get such a big visceral reaction from a crowd. Like, yeah, everyone knows him now, but even then, like, there's kids who are probably like chanting along because he's doing his yes thing or he's just being really entertaining.
It's that innate charisma that draws people to him on top of his elite level ring work. Once people emotionally invest in Daniel Bryan, it's hard for them to stop being fans. It's what makes Brian excel when he's placed into incredibly emotional and compelling storylines. You feel his indignant rage at Takeshi Morishima for nearly blinding him in New York City. You chant yes at him because you want to believe that for once, just once, the good guy can win and talent wins out over marketing. You boo the planet's champion despite his entirely correct philosophies because it stings to see him reverse the dismissive rhetoric once thrown at him at another wrestler who also happens to be a person of color. It's also that innate charisma that has allowed him to seamlessly transition between different roles in different companies. I think a lot of people take for granted just how much and how often Brian has transformed his character throughout his career. Over the years, Brian has been the scrappy babyface technician, the bully heel champion, the ace of the independents, half of a comedy heel tag team, the most relatable babyface in the WWE, and then its most hated heel. All of this continually shifting and adjusting his character without ever sacrificing the essential core of his personality. Through every iteration of Daniel Bryan, he's been a passionate and intense pro wrestler that believes in the power of his ability to manifest change around him. That consistency through all his various gimmicks means that no shift ever feels out of place, regardless of how different one gimmick may be from another. It's also that consistency that almost disguises how versatile Brian has been as a character worker. There's no noticeable shift in ring gear, there's no bedazzled jackets or three-piece suit. It's the same man every time, tapping into a new aspect of his personality, but doing it so flawlessly that you hardly feel the change. I think that two different transitions display this best in his career. The first in 2009, as he went from the veritable king of the independents, undisputed best wrestler in the world, to nerdy indie prospect geek in the big C that is the WWE in less than a year. Somehow entirely fitting while being two completely distinct characters. Then there's 2018, where he went from conquering hero, returning from years-long injury, into evil tree-hugging socialist heel, again, doing so in less than a year. Very few GOAT candidates can make a claim to this level of reinvention and versatility throughout their careers. Perhaps the closest comparison would be someone like Terry Funk, who just organically evolved throughout his career and with the shifting wrestling industry around him. Someone like Chris Jericho makes a show of his reinvention, drawing attention to it so that we notice the shift and in turn offer him praise for it. It's a valid approach, and your mileage may vary on how successful he's been in completing those transitions, but for me personally, it's a far less interesting method of reinvention when you're basically going out on TV and announcing, "Hey look, I'm reinventing myself." It lacks nuance, it lacks depth. Pro wrestling is about the suspension of disbelief. It's about kayfabe, creating an illusion of organic unity. Going out and branding yourself as a reverend of reinvention goes against that idea entirely. On top of all the more quantifiable traits of Daniel Bryan's performance character work, there's something a little more intangible beneath it all. There's a charm to him that can't quite be articulated. He's compelling to watch not just intellectually, but emotionally as well. I really don't know how to describe it other than you just like the guy. And even when you're not supposed to like him, you believe in him still.
Shima! I'm gonna fly this son of a bitch!
Now that I've covered the aspects of Bryan's in-ring performance, let's talk about the ways in which Bryan has affected the wrestling world at large. Influence is always difficult to measure for a wrestler who's still active, but in the 20 years or so of Bryan's career, he's already affected some massive changes in the industry. Let's start with the most obvious ones. Alongside CM Punk, Bryan has helped influence the influx of independent talent into the WWE. While I'll happily concede that Punk achieved success in the WWE much earlier than Bryan and probably deserves the lion's share of the credit for this point, the antagonistic stance that so many high-ranking officials have in the WWE for Punk make me feel that Bryan had a large effect on this matter as well. Bryan's continued longevity and success in the WWE has made the independent scene the go-to breeding ground for future WWE talent.
I think without Bryan Danielson, we don't have guys his size going to the WWE and making a career. You know, he's only like maybe 5'8", 185 pounds, and before guys like Bryan Danielson, you know, they weren't signing anyone that small, really, unless you were, you know, best worker in the world, Rey Mysterio type guys, you know? And so you had best independent wrestler out there, Bryan Danielson, getting signed. Which opened up a whole new window of opportunity for the last 10 years of independent workers, you know, to say the least. Pretty influential, I have to say.
Just seeing him on NXT was kind of a light bulb for me, like, oh, you know, this guy has gone on to this and is creating a new, I don't know if niche is the right word, but just a new avenue for wrestlers like us. You know, I know it was CM Punk, Matt Sydal, and Danielson, who I had looked to and seen their success and thought like, wow, they're really opening up the doors for, you know, guys like us, and just kind of the state of NXT of the last 5 years, actually.
But in terms of the influence he's had on me, I guess just seeing his rise throughout every promotion he's been a part of, and knowing that he's not the tallest, he's not the biggest, that was something that, you know, I held near and dear to my heart, because I've always been the shorter kid. If I look back at all my school photos, I was always in one of the bottom rows of all the bleachers because I wasn't tall enough to stand up the back. So it was cool to see someone that wasn't a giant be able to conquer an industry that was generally only having giants at the top.
Bryan has also left a lasting mark on independent wrestling in general. not only in helping foster the idea of the American independent scene as a place where one might find the next best wrestler in the world, but also in influencing future generations of pro wrestlers that have come after him.
As a professional wrestler, for me, I obviously use a lot of his offense, and I do the double arm stomps, I'll do the tiger frame backflip, stuff like that. The main thing I try to take away from him is his intensity and how real he makes things seem. His influence is understated, like you can see it in almost every wrestler now.
As a pro wrestler, DLson's had a lot of influences on me. Obviously, you know, the nickname Italian American Dragon is partially a joke because of Danielson. But also, like, Danielson was one of the first guys to really bring Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu into pro wrestling. He was doing a lot of sequences with, like, Low Key and guys like that, you know, in the years between, like, 02 and 06, when, like, that stuff was not in vogue in pro wrestling. Like, obviously, with my grappling style, my background in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, it's something that I've looked into and looked for ways to, you know, bring myself into the forefront and pull from him and things like that. One of the first things I show the kids at the ARW school is I show them this clip from a Danielson seminar where he talks about, you know, making sacrifices of stuff you might not want to do, you know, to be successful in pro wrestling. And I think Danielson, that's something I took from Brian, is there's a lot of times where I don't want to do stuff in pro wrestling, but, you know, if I want to get to where I want to get, I've got to do these things.
I think there's wrestlers from a certain generation that are now kind of in the limelight to a degree that would definitely take inspiration from Brian Danielson's influence. I know I get comparisons in the ring whenever I throw a chest kick to someone that's kneeling or on both knees. Instantly the crowd will chant yes, 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 which is cool because I don't do that as a direct homage to Brian Danielson, but if the fans want to pick up on that and use it in that way, it means they're engaging with what I'm doing and they're having fun. So I think his influence is going to be felt for a long time to come still, because there are still some younger wrestlers coming up now that aren't in that spotlight yet that probably grew up with Brian Danielson as an influence to them.
Brian the wrestler is pretty much the epitome of the kind of guy you want to pattern yourself off of athletically. He trains so consistently. He trains with great intensity, and he's very smart about the way he trains, and he trains in a specific way. And you know, he's one of those first guys that I talked to that was basically, he would tell me he doesn't lift heavy weights, he doesn't train like a bodybuilder, he trains more like a fighter. And at the time, this is mid-2000s, it was crazy to me because I always thought, you know, he had to, you know, lift like one of these big dudes, one of these big muscular guys to get in shape for wrestling. And he kind of shed some more light on that. So he definitely influenced me there.
Brian Danielson has influenced my style a lot, because when I got into wrestling, I knew I wasn't really going to be a powerhouse or a high flyer. I was always drawn more to the grappling and technique focused side of wrestling, and he was able to make that work really well for him, especially adding the aggressive side, which I'm a big fan of. So I think if you were to credit my style, he's probably top three for that.
I remember my last two singles matches with him. One was PWG, one was Ring of Honor, late 2009, September, I believe. And they were both different matches, and they were probably about a week apart, but were both, you know, vital matches for my career. You know, people still talk to me about that PWG match. Him beating me, no one expected that at all, and the crowd was just incredibly excited. And then to defeat him in Ring of Honor in a singles match in my hometown of Dayton, Ohio, is a nice little tidbit for me to have, and it lent credibility to my character at the time, who was trying to work his way out of the mid card, you know, with that young knockout kid and, you know, the loaded elbow pad. And, you know, I achieved a certain amount of success with that, and then led into rejoining the Kings of Wrestling, and that was, you know, very pivotal for me.
I think the influence on me is probably pretty obvious. The cattle mutilation is something that I've used as a finisher for many years. Something he used as a finisher. I think that's a bit of a nod to him. The dropkick in the corner is something that he does that I also do. There's times where I feel like maybe I'm a little too on my sleeve when it comes to showing my Bryan Danielson influences. No one's ever called me on it, so please don't. I'm very conscious of it. I'm trying to not be a bad, out of shape Bryan Danielson, but you know, he's obviously someone I take influence from and someone that I'd like to give little nods to. Occasionally, I'll do the classic I have until five referee, which is very much specifically a nod to him. And it's something I do as a bit of a nod to him when working as a heel. Also, because it works, typically. Crowds always react to it. They love that. So, sorry, I'm gonna keep doing it.
His time in the WWE has also significantly changed major aspects of the company from a creative standpoint for both the good and the bad. Perhaps the most apparent of these creative changes is that since Bryan's rise to the WrestleMania main event in 2014, WWE has just completely forgotten how to book babyfaces properly. In their eternal attempt to recreate the spark of Bryan's rise to the top, WWE have somehow decided that bad booking is good booking simply because one truly transcendent star was able to overcome their ineptitude. I know this might sound like a negative on Bryan's part in that he started the WWE's incapability to create credible babyfaces, but it's actually a point in his favor. The man surpassed every attempt the WWE made to keep him down and buried, and it's not his fault that a historically incompetent company took entirely the wrong lessons from that. Daniel Bryan's star power and popularity in the WWE is so strong that it actively disrupted WWE creative for years to come. Roman Reigns, a genuinely talented and skilled performer, had his momentum completely tanked and ruined for years by both the fans and the WWE. Why? He committed the sin of not being Daniel Bryan. Bryan's popularity was so powerful that his mere absence ruined the Royal Rumble as a trusted milestone in the WWE calendar. Ever since he wasn't booked in the 2014 Rumble and failed to win the 2015 Rumble, the Royal Rumble has always been looked at with a certain sense of trepidation and doubt. It's taken years to rehabilitate its image from that point, and to this day, Roman Reigns still gets heat for merely entering the Rumble at all. Again, all of this simply because Bryan wasn't even present one time. In just the last 2 years, Bryan has made another major change to the industry. In February 2016, Bryan announced that due to a long history of head and neck injuries, including severe concussions, he had been forced into early retirement. After years away from the ring, Bryan announced in early 2018 that he had finally been cleared to return to active in-ring competition, and he has been wrestling regularly ever since. Just 2 years after Bryan's return, Edge makes a triumphant return to WWE by entering the 2020 Royal Rumble after 9 years in retirement from lingering spinal injuries. I don't think it's too much of a stretch to say that Daniel Bryan's return to the ring set the precedent for WWE to potentially reevaluate workers they had once deemed unable to ever return to the ring for potential returns. Retired wrestlers like Paige have even gone on record to point to Daniel Bryan as an inspiration and a source of hope that one day their condition might improve enough to allow them to return to the ring.
You know, now as a wrestler, being able to see him come back from such serious injuries and still perform pretty much the best he ever has, it gives me hope that any injury I face is manageable and I can get through it. He truly is an inspiration in a lot of different ways.
Daniel Bryan has changed the industry, often without actively even trying.
I personally think that he's probably the best wrestler on the planet Earth, and always will be to me. Yeah, I think he's the greatest.
I would say that Bryan Danielson reaches top five levels of all-time wrestlers. I don't know if I can quite say he's the best of all time. That could be that could be argued from here till the end of time. I will say I think he's the best wrestler of the last 20 years. You know, of course, many people would probably have their arguments as to who the greatest of all time is. And you know, when it comes down to technical skill, he sure might be the greatest of all time. On top of, you know, being able to pace a match and execute a match. But, you know, I put him top five of all time and easily the best wrestler of the last two decades between 2000 and 2020.
I do truly think if you look at wrestler as the term, Bryan Danielson may be one of the best ever. When it comes to performer or entertainer, there might be some other people that could trump him. But in between the ropes, he'd easily be one of the greatest. Definitely someone I wish I could learn from. Someone that I think has impacted my generation's pro wrestlers heavily and way more than any of us will ever understand. And I can't wait to just see what else he does with the rest of his career.
I know this is a bold claim to some, but I do think that Bryan Danielson is the greatest professional wrestler of all time for all the reasons that I mentioned before. You could put him in any country, in any style. As a matter of fact, you could put him in any time period. If he had a time machine, you could just drop him anywhere. He could go work the carnivals back in the 1900s. He could work the territories in the 70s. He could, you know, go to present day and just absolutely kick ass. He's just so good at so many different things. And that, to me, is the true sign of a great professional wrestler. That, to me, is why Bryan Danielson, when all is said and done, will be the greatest professional wrestler of all time.
I think in ranking Bryan Danielson as the greatest of all time, he's definitely the best to come from the independent scene. And when it's all said and done, he's retired, he is going to be in the conversation for the greatest of all time.
What I will say is that I believe the measure of a pro wrestler is the ability to have compelling, interesting matches with opponents of every type. Tall, short, skinny, muscle-bound, rookies, veterans, matches that involve stipulations and matches with opponents that may be injured and that you have to work around certain things. When I watch Bryan, I can see that he's always doing his best to bring the best out of his opponent. And that's what the all-time greats are good at. And that is something that if we look back on his work 10 years from now, his entire body of work, aside from it being a shame that he had to take a bit of a hiatus, we'll be able to see just the caliber of matches he had for, you know, 15 out of 20 years.
Bryan Danielson, I have to say, you know, it feels too early to say greatest of all time, but we're talking the guy's been a pro for over 20 years now. That seems crazy. He debuted in 1999. That's wild. I don't think it's out of line to say that he will probably go down as the one of the greatest independent pro wrestlers of all time, and certainly one of the greatest pro wrestlers of all time, period.
The debate as to who the greatest wrestler of all time is will rage on long after you have watched this video. Odds are some of you will remain unconvinced, and that's fair enough. Wrestling history has spanned decades, and there's a handful of viable candidates that anyone could build their case around if they had the time and the patience. It's a fun enough debate when done right, mostly because it forces us to examine our own ideas of what makes good and bad pro wrestling, and articulating that always has value. And at the end of the day, that's what my overall analysis rests on. Daniel Bryan represents everything that I feel pro wrestling can be and should be. Mechanically fantastic in the ring, emotionally compelling outside of it, multifaceted and complex as a performer, someone who dedicates their time and thought to the craft of the performance. And I've said this in the past, to me, wrestling is a feeling. You know quality when you see it, then you pick it apart to understand how it works. That's what Daniel Bryan gives to me as a fan. The feeling of watching greatness, then the satisfaction of having that feeling validated by rewatch and study. Which leaves me to my last point. One that holds the least water in a quantitative argument, but holds the most value for me personally. Daniel Bryan is the greatest wrestler of all time, because no one makes me love professional wrestling as much as he does. It's the final countdown!
Hello everybody, I got the quarantine hair, I got the Bryan Danielson t-shirt, but I just wanted to take this time to send my thanks out to all the people who helped me put together this video, my longest one yet. First of all, I really want to say thank you to my Ko-fi supporters. This time I want to say thank you to Juan C. Gonzalez, Chase Burnett, Barry McHugh, Stephen McClanahan, Inie Banigo, at NUFC Monkey, and a special thank you to my monthly Ko-fi supporters, that's James Draper, Jake Dieterich, and Captain Jack Heartless. I want to say a big thank you to my cousin, Michelle Melchor, who did that wonderful sketch drawing of Bryan, as well as providing me with the time-lapse footage of her putting that together. I want to say thank you to my podcasting friends from the wrestling world, Jamesy of the British Wrestling Experience podcast, as well as the Grapple App Match of the Month podcast, and Quentin Moody of the QNTR, as well as the Psychology is Dead podcast. Thank you guys for contributing to this video, and a huge, huge thank you to all the pro wrestlers who indulged this silly fan and decided to take part in this project. So a big thank you goes out to Eddie Kingston, Daniel Maccabe, Dominic Guarini, Kevin Koo, Robbie Eagles, Eric Stevens, Lee Moriarty, and Chris Hero. You guys are some of the absolute best in the world. You guys rule. Thank you so much for doing this for me. And thank you, of course, to all of you out there who are watching. Thank you to everyone who got me to 2,000 plus subscribers. You guys are absolutely awesome. Don't forget to stay home if you can. Flatten the curve and help those who can't help themselves. You guys have been absolutely wonderful. Thank you and have a good one.